32 years ago, Final Fantasy entered the video game world, a series that I wholeheartedly stand by. Over the years, the series has been crowned the king of its genre, having changed the video game industry and the lives of those who experience it. In time, the series has fallen into a veil of darkness with much of the fanbase, ultimately losing its royal reputation. But what if I told you that I believe Final Fantasy XV to be one of the most faithful entries to the series' classic concepts, beautifully reminding me of the old Crystal era titles, and wholly fulfilling its mission to reclaim the sacred JRPG throne. A narrative deeply rooted in darkness, light, adventure, and brotherhood. Allow me to regale you with a tale. Long ago, there were six divine beings having sworn guidance and protection over the world of Eos. Titan the Archaean, Rama the Fulgarian, Shiva the Glacian, Leviathan the Hydrian, Bahamut the Draconian, and Ifrit the Infernian. Since time immemorial, they have watched over Eos, primarily building trust with the citizens of Solheim, a now ancient civilization. In time, the people began searching for new heights of power, thus driving Ifrit to retaliate and punish mankind for their betrayal. But as the Six had made an oath to protect these people, they turned on Ifrit, thus the War of the Astrals began. Per this great war of old, the realm of Solheim was left in ashes and ruin, and the Six fell into slumber. In order to provide a newfound hope for mankind, the gods would grant Eos a king, blessed with a divine ring and crystal for protection. Mysteriously, a plague called the Star Scourge ravaged mankind, a tiny menace that twisted men into monsters. In Lucis lived a savior who could cure the afflicted. His body would come to host myriad demons, that countless lives be spared. But a jealous king, one not yet chosen by the crystal, ostracized and demonized this healer of the people, making a true monster of him. Deemed unclean by this parasite, this healer was rejected as the founder king and forced to live as an immortal, never to be freed from his wretched curse. Arden Lucis Kylam swore vengeance upon the gods, promising to one day drive the world into endless darkness and end the Lucis king's bloodline once and for all. In a time unknown, only a prophecy keeps hope alive in the hearts of the people. When darkness veils the world, the King of Light shall come. Noctis Lucis Kylam, heir to the throne of Lucis, and his best friends, Gladiolus, Ignis, and Prompto. These guys are instantly likable, but you have no idea how much you'll fall in love with these characters over the course of your adventure. In FF15, you get to explore the open world rather than an overworld, and even though I'm not the biggest fan of open world games, this decision was perfect. Instead of a linear story driving the game, the characters drive the story as you embark on this road trip with your best friends in your luxurious car, the Regalia. This being a road trip themed adventure is a testament to the design philosophy behind the Final Fantasy brand. Redefine your expectations of what a FF game can be, looking for ways to innovate and to deliver a fantastic experience. Now, four brave warriors begin their journey, prepared to fight. What awaits the four, however, they do not know. Another way the developers looked for a way to challenge themselves was to align the battle system with the heart of the game. This is the first time in the series that the battle system is completely action-based, officially called the Active Cross-Battle System. Noctis is the specialist of any weapon, but is the only one who can equip short swords and warp strike. Gladio is your typical knight, wielding great swords and shields. Ignis is actually a nice mix between a dragoon, thief, and geomancer, specializing in elemental properties. Prompto is the long-range gunner who can also use tools, heavily inspired by Final Fantasy VI's Edgar. I love the action RPG system in this game, because it's actually a storytelling method to express the unity of the friends. Learning teamwork techniques through the Ascension Grid. This is also a way to boost stats and further develop each character's hobbies. I've found that I'm most intrigued by the magic creation and cooking buffs to progress the party members, though. The magic system is derivative of FF8's junction system, in which the spells are akin to items. You can mix these spells with items or ingredients you find in the game to create some pretty powerful magic. It's a thrill to see what you can come up with. You can also use these ingredients for Ignis to cook meals at camp, giving stat boosts along with certain immunities to elements and status effects. An interesting take on the leveling system is letting you essentially bank your experience points and combine them with multipliers to become insanely powerful. Final Fantasy XV is definitely one of the easiest games in the series, but the battle system is quite fluid and exciting. And I love how each character has their own unique battle system to switch things up at any time. I love when these games offer replay value, so these variant battle systems and customizations offer a lot of fun to be had. This game has a true touching side, though, and much of that is attributed to the beautiful soundtrack. The battles all have their upbeat themes, but when it comes time to get serious and reflect, Yoko Shimomura has created gold. It all seems to have been written to show you how special the bond is between these four friends. The main theme of the game is actually a cover of Ben King's Stand By Me. The game is structured as a character-driven story rather than plot-driven, which is thematically consistent, inspired by the film of the same name, about four friends going on a journey together. Not only do you get this great soundtrack, the party also gets to listen to all of the other FF soundtracks in the car as you drive. This game must know my tastes, because the first three soundtracks you obtain are my three favorite FF soundtracks, 4, 8, and 2. Square also went out of their way to hire work to the legendary Nobuo Uematsu with Choosing Hope, and Ignis' theme by the also legendary Yasunori Matsuda. It is widely known that Final Fantasy IX is in many ways a tribute to the original Final Fantasy game's style and setting. But I would argue that Final Fantasy XV is as much of a tribute, but more so in concept and story format. With this comes plenty of homages that are subtly expressed. First off, the general story of Final Fantasy XV is kind of like a mix between the first five games. A prophecy is stated that when the world is covered in darkness, a hero of light shall come, just like in the opening text of the original game. The cool thing this time is that there is a point when the world literally is covered in darkness. And I mean, you even start your journey with the king sending you off. In FF2, you begin the game playing as four friends that are on the run after their hometown is destroyed by the Empire. Now, I've always seen FF3 as a coming-of-age story itself, since the four kids are chosen to take on great responsibility. In FF4, of course you have your hero who grows over time to become the king of his land. FF5 possibly has the most homages in Final Fantasy XV. Arden's story reminds me so much of Exdeath's. It was the bloodline of the main character that was responsible for sealing away the evil threat, that ultimately was free to seek revenge. There are also plenty of monster designs in this game that are heavily derivative of FF5, which I'll talk more about that later. All of these insights aren't surprising though. The development team stated that the early FF games, primarily the 2D era, stood as the most influential for Final Fantasy XV's development. Have you ever wondered why Noctis has a small gap in between his pants and boots? Well, check it out. Even the hairstyle is similar. The party experiences a sudden maturity after encountering Bahamut. Even the dungeons feel straight out of the classics. There's an actual dungeon that is underwater, reminding me so much of the sunken shrine of FF1. Also, the Dar'el caverns take me back to inside Leviathan in Final Fantasy II, as you wade through the poisonous waters. I know these things are small, but that's something so special about FF15 that is so easy to miss. It's one of those games where the finer details truly matter. Even in the vision and development process for this game, they literally went on road trips across the world to be inspired by real locations. Alticia is set to be like Venice, and it has a Colosseum directly from Rome, Italy. The gas stations and shops are designed to express 1950s Midwestern America. And Lestalem is inspired by Cuba, Malaysia, and Morocco. The developers also cooked each of Ignis's meals for themselves in real life. Say what you want about Final Fantasy XV, but there was a clear, galvanized vision for this game. The side quests in Final Fantasy XV are extensive, but I do think it's some of the best optional content in the series. There are many small side quests to do for the citizens of Eos, such as frog catching, helping stranded travelers, and even weapon upgrading with Cid. These quests can seem mundane at times, but I think it enhances the relationship between the future king and his people, selflessly serving them. And since they think Noctis is dead and most people don't recognize you, it has a good Samaritan feel to it. Let's get to the real fun stuff though. The hunt system from FF12 has come back, and that will always be welcome. I think the most important side quest is unlocking all of the royal arms, which are weapons left at the graves of the previous kings. This will take you to some incredible locations, such as the Rock at Ravatar. Some optional quests are actually collaborations with other games, such as Final Fantasy XIV, where you can get my favorite weapons in the game, and Terra Wars, created by Hironobu Sakaguchi himself. You can, of course, unlock chocobos and travel off-road much faster. Chocobo racing also makes its comeback. You can go fishing pretty much anywhere. Once I mastered this minigame, it's become one of my favorites for sure. Remember the Rome-inspired Colosseum I mentioned in Altitia? Well, you can actually make bets on monster fights to win some pretty cool prizes. Justice Monsters 5 is a pinball game within the world of 15. It's simple, but the art style and music make it a sweet experience. It also makes a fun way to unlock some great accessories early on in the game. This minigame was also released as an app in the real world as well, one of the many pieces of the FF15 universe. There's another mobile game called Final Fantasy XV: A New Empire, and all of the spin-off titles released actually are super fun. A King's Tale is a 2D beat-em-up that is a bedtime story that King Regis tells Noctis as a kid. Monster of the Deep is a PlayStation VR fishing game where you not only fish, but have to fight demon fish with a crossbow. Comrades is a multiplayer expansion that takes place during the World of Ruin that was actually initially released as DLC for 15, but is now its own exclusive experience. And all of these games were way better than I expected them to be, and all are some of my favorite spin-offs in the Final Fantasy series. The Kingsglaive movie and the Brotherhood and Arden Prologue animes are all worth checking out as well. As soon as it's released in English, I definitely plan on reading the upcoming Dawn of the Future novel. There is so much in this universe, but I can honestly say that it all has impressed me. Even the Pocket Edition is worth playing, mainly for the extra story dungeon based around Shiva. Back to the game's side quests though, you can take part in quests to unlock upgrades for the Regalia as well as different models such as the Regalia Type D to go off-roading. It's a blast. I do love this because a group of four dudes together would totally do something this stupid, and it works. Then you can unlock the Regalia Type F, which is this game's airship. It's a fun fact that this is the first controllable airship in the main series since Final Fantasy IX. Possibly my favorite side quest in this game is only obtainable through the airship. You can land in the depths of the Ravitog Mountains to come across a hidden entrance to a stony foundation. Remember hidden areas like this in older FF games? The Deep Sea Research Center in FF8 comes to my mind. Dark, eerie, abandoned, and endlessly mysterious. I love when games add in elements of horror, and the dungeon that you unravel is unlike anything ever experienced before in Final Fantasy. The Pityos Ruins is a dungeon that you must traverse without fighting anything. Rather, it's a set of puzzles set within the dark remains of the old Solheim civilization. What happened here? What does it all mean? I don't know, but that's what makes it so special. And you can get some really good stuff here, but the experience is what makes it worth it. Final Fantasy XV is full of super dungeons like this, and they're all tied in with the lore of the game, and that's what I find so impressive about them. You can find datalog entries across the world that build the mystery behind these areas. The Kosselmark Tower is also one that is part of Solheim's old civilization, where you navigate a maze to ultimately find a boss that definitely doesn't want to be interrupted. Finally, I must talk about the sealed door dungeons that are the ultimate challenge. Deep underground are menaces that are locked away behind these doors. These dungeons are all dark and full of tough stuff to face. This always follows with superb weapons and equipment though that make it all worth it. And plus, all the monsters look incredible. I've stated that I believe Final Fantasy V to have the best monster design in the series, but I want to alter that a little. If FF15 doesn't tie first place, it's an easy second place. Excellence is an understatement. Speaking of FF5, there are several bosses and super bosses that are taken directly from it. Gilgamesh is one, of course, which is a more serious take this time. Melusine, which is probably my favorite monster throwback. And Omega, which is the toughest super boss in the game. That's not all though. The Garula and Ronin designs also pay tribute to FF5. Remember Chaturnuk, the painting in FF6? Every notable and recurring FF monster could arguably have its best designs in 15. Goblin? Bomb? Flan? Marlboro? Katoblipas? Behemoth? Naga? Arachnid? Tonberry? Look at the Lich. It's amazing. And the Iron Giant is my favorite FF monster, and it's the perfect 3D design. It must be noted that the developers wanted to express the classic FF monsters as they would behave in their natural habitat in the wild. I don't know how you could top this. There are just tons and tons of examples here. And to top it off, I must mention the Adamantus, which is probably the intended ultimate super boss in 15. It's literally a mountain. I thought 13's was big. The original monsters exclusively in 15 are fantastic too, such as the crippling battle against the rare MAX Angelus Zero machine, and usually drop some great equipment. The summons are the divine astrals from the lore, and return to their spell-based format from FF3 through 9, the way I prefer it. These battles, along with the flawless monster designs, cement Final Fantasy XV with having some of the most breathtaking moments in the entire series. Not long after this game released, my oldest brother passed away, and it was certainly unexpected. He was a lot older than me, so most of the memories I have with him were from my early childhood. We had made plans to spend more time together to develop more memories, but before I knew it, he was gone. The reason I bring this up is that many people talk about how Luna's fate was underdeveloped. And I agree. But I believe that's the point. Sometimes we lose those in life that we should have spent more time with. And that can be just as awful. Even though I do have dear memories as a young kid with him, I mostly miss the memories that I never got to make with my brother. Final Fantasy XV shares a meaningful lesson about life. Noctis lost his father, mother, and future bride without a proper goodbye. A goodbye filled with time and memories to endorse it. Instead, the prince is left with remorse and guilt for missed opportunities. This only christens the relationship with Noctis' friends, which is the true love story of 15. While everything around him crumbles, his brother stood beside him. The cast of 15 is small, but this is where the heart of the game lies. My favorite character in Final Fantasy 15 is Prompto. He's the one that wants to make sure the group is entertained and comfortable, with a camera always in hand. I relate so much with this character because we share those traits. And my group of friends from back in the day, I was always the guy with the camera, trying to make jokes and make sure everyone is happy. But deep down is a guy that seeks the approval of his buds. He makes the experience for me, easily one of my favorite characters in the series. Ignis is the rational thinker and responsible one. He's the guy in the group that if everyone else is laughing at something, he could just be sitting there in silence, which makes the situation that much more hilarious. He's also quite skilled in the culinary arts, which means he would get along very well with Quina from FF9. Gladio is the tough guy, the one that pushes you to your limits to be better. I typically don't like these types of characters as much, but Gladio is a special addition to the group. Each of the guys have a special bond with Noctis, but Gladio is the one that serves as the ultimate protector and shield. And finally, we have Prince Noctis. I can't think of many more examples in a video game where I truly feel the love that the other characters have for one person. Probably my favorite part of the game is where Noctis and Gladio argue on the train. What proceeds is only silence between the four friends, as you traverse through a dungeon to obtain the next royal arm. The tension is so thick because you just spent hours with this adventurous road trip between these best friends. FF15 does not get enough credit for its clever storytelling methods. In this moment, my heart is completely sunk, as if I am one of those friends. As you reach the Empire's headquarters to retrieve the crystal, one of the ultimate throwback moments follows. And a villain revelation only as shocking as the finale in the original Final Fantasy.
The jealous king, one chosen by the crystal, ostracized and demonized this healer of the people, making a true monster of him. I gave you my name earlier, but you should know that it was not one given to me at birth. Arden Lucis Kylam is my proper name.
As you wake from your 10-year slumber, you enter the world of ruin, shrouded in darkness. The reunion with your friends should be a happy one, but as you prepare and have your last meal together, you experience one of the best builds to a finale ever crafted for the series. You know that this is the last time doing this with your friends. And most importantly, you feel that. Entering the ruins of where your adventure started, just like in the 1987 classic. Insomnia Ruins is the final dungeon of FF15, and it is a really good one. The city is filled with darkness, ashes, and tough enemies to fight. My favorite monster here is the Behemoth King. It looks just like the one conceived in the Yoshitaka Amano artwork for FF1. I know I keep talking about FF1, but I see so many similarities here. The city is huge, with plenty of places to explore. There are some quests here too that will teach you more about the former kings of Lucis, and that's always a plus. The super boss Omega is roaming around too, if you feel powerful enough to take it on. My favorite item to obtain here is definitely from defeating this ghost. You can obtain the daggers that belong to Nyx from Kingsglaive. Does this mean that this ghost is Nyx? That's another nice detail about FF15. There's plenty of mystery and subtle secrets. The time has come to reclaim the throne. The final boss gauntlet starts with Cerberus guarding the gates to Arden's tower. Look how amazing this monster design is. And next is Ifrit, sitting on his throne. And this image is just like the Yoshitaka Amano artwork of Chaos from FF1. This is an epic encounter, and I'm glad that Demon Ifrit made a return. I like him more than the Beast Ifrit that has been in the design since FF8. The next few boss fights keep raising the level of this stellar climax, filling you with the classic Final Fantasy finale feels. Take down the rulers of yore with the help of your friends, and prepare for the Battle of Kings.
When the night has come and the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see, no, I won't be afraid. Oh, I won't be afraid, just as long as you stand by me. So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Oh, stand now. Stand by me. Stand by me. If the sky that we look upon should tumble and fall, or the mountain just as long as you stay, stand by.
It's all about the journey. Bow down to the king of RPGs. Something I've always cherished about Final Fantasy is that it is much more than a game series to me. In this case, with Final Fantasy XV, it's made me reflect on some of the dearest times in my life. A time when all that seemed to matter was time with your bros. The times I shared growing up with my brothers and my best friends are sadly times that I know I won't ever get back. But they mean everything to me. 15 captures that very feeling. The feeling of just going on a road trip with the guys. Taking stupid pictures. Laughing. Crying. This is a special game. Even just looking in the background during camping. Or even all the pictures you took during your experience. They're all such small touches that make this game a masterpiece in my eyes. You take a look back and realize that all the time you spent on things that didn't really matter actually do. There's a tiny moment at the end of a side quest where you're on a treasure hunt. You find the treasure with a note that reads, "The treasure is not what you find at Journey's End, but the journey itself." This is what Final Fantasy XV means to me. Remember that the next time you're with people that are important to you, that life is short, so make the most of it. I think that's something we all can agree on. As for my best friends and my brothers, you guys are the best. Final Fantasy XV is a Final Fantasy for fans and first-timers. I recently posted a question on Reddit for newcomers to share their experience with Final Fantasy XV if it was their first in the series. Reading similar emotional responses from people declaring that they get why they've always heard that Final Fantasy is a must-have experience. That the ending made them cry. That it's the best journey they've ever been on. The same feeling I had when I first experienced the series as well. I get it too. Now one of my favorites in the series, Final Fantasy still lives on, and I will always stand by it. No wonder the series creator Hironobu Sakaguchi loves Final Fantasy XV. It is of utmost reverence to his greatest creation.
Thank you.